has a friend or coworker ever come up to you and pulled out their wallet or their phone and expected you to fawn over these pictures of their newborn baby, and you think, you know what? This baby's just not really that cute. I'd much rather be looking at a picture of some baby hedgehogs, which really are that cute. Aww. Just look at them. If you feel this way, you're not alone. A quick glimpse at almost anyone's social media feed confirms humans' bias for non-human infants over infants of our own species. Just look at these adorable owlets that showed up on my feed 2 weeks ago. And now these owlets are complete strangers to me. And yet, I am more likely to like and share this photo than a photo of my cousin's new baby. Like, why is that? And in general, this is true. We went on Facebook, we looked, and we found that while babies might go viral for doing or saying something especially adorable, pictures and videos of baby animals doing absolutely nothing of consequence go viral all the time. This photo has been up for a little under a week, and it already has 255,000 upvotes. How can that be? Well, for confirmation of the inferior cuteness of human infants, we really need to look no further than the infants themselves. Human babies, they just don't really seem to be trying in the cuteness department. Yeah, they're kind of cute, but they lack a lot of obviously appealing traits. How much cuter would babies be with enormous ears, fluffy fur feathers, or short little tails? And we can see that because human parents even see the need to enhance the cuteness of their infants by dressing them up like the infants of other species. So, why would that be? That makes no evolutionary sense. Human babies are our only hope for the survival of the human race, and animal babies were probably just a high-calorie meal for our ancestors. So why should we associate these strong protective feelings with a thing that's not even from our own species? Well, the answer, it's pretty simple. My desire to cuddle and hug and protect cute animal babies derived from my ancestors' desire to get paid. You see, our theory proposes that in the evolutionary environment before the advent of the written word, the first economies were actually based off of using baby animals as currency. And you know, much in the way that people express, you know, feelings of affection towards money now, we can see that in the evolutionary environment, people became affectionate and they became protective of the source of their wealth. Now, meanwhile, in that same period, the human infants, which most resembled animal infants, they were simply traded away for goods and services. So, they didn't survive to reproduce, and natural selection worked in favor of uglier babies. And that really led us to the more mediocre human cuteness that we see today. Babies had to be cute enough that their parents were willing to keep them around, but not so cute that other people who would have traded them away for goods and services would really find them appealing. And now, we really think that at the same time in history is when babies evolved other mechanisms not to be traded away, such as being annoyingly loud and difficult to transport. So why use baby animals as currency? Well, one obvious advantage is portability. Just look at how neatly all of these kittens fit in this suitcase. you can easily imagine them being slid across a tree stump to sweeten the prehistoric deal. And this is really truly what would have been referred to as a fat stack of cats. And now there were a lot of hidden benefits too, because just look how quickly one rabbit goes from being docile and easy to transport to being large and unwieldy. And now this really made it so that people needed to spend their money while it remained portable. And people couldn't hoard wealth. It stimulated the prehistoric economy. It did. And now I'd like to invite my colleague to present some of the evidence for our theory.
Yes, thank you very much. So one thing that all currency needs to have is it needs to be rare to some extent. This is basic economic theory. You can't just have gold coins lying all over the ground. There'd be massive inflation and the whole system would collapse. So if our theory is true and the animals which we today consider cute were once used by our ancestors as currency, those animals should be relatively rare, at least when we look at the big picture. And look at a big picture, we shall. So, as you can see here, I'm gonna dive into this subcategory, animals, because it's the only potentially cute one on that list. And then here, you can see that only 0.45% of that 0.5% of Earth's biomass is consistently cute biomass. I know that fish have some fans, but let's be real here. Now, we're not saying that there wasn't experimentation in the past. It may have been that some human societies used, for example, insects as currency, and consequently may have even evolved to find those insects cute. We can't really say. There's no written records from the time period. However, based on the general lack of warm feelings that we feel towards insects today, we can surmise that those individuals did not survive to reproduce. Now, just like their modern-day counterparts, our ancient ancestors valued liquidity in their currency. And for them, that meant ease of transport and ease of exchange. In other words, smallness. And this led to the well-known inverse relationship between size and cuteness that we can still observe today. We've done some original research in this area. So we conducted a study in which we asked our respondents to rate which picture of a hedgehog they preferred based on cuteness. Now, note that the lower hedgehog is exactly one half the radius of the larger hedgehog. And I can hear what your objection is already forming in your head. You're saying hedgehogs aren't spheres. This is a ridiculous abstraction. But I'd like to point out that radius is actually the important factor here, since it would have affected, in prehistoric times, how many hedgehogs could fit into a suitcase or traveling bag. And as you can see, the data totally bears us out. The smaller hedgehog is preferred. We found even that our data fit a rather nice inverse squared relationship in the radius of the hedgehog. Indeed, it could be said to fit the data quite snugly. Now, this is a quote, a real quote from a real person. One of our respondents, note how he phrases his preference for the smaller hedgehog in terms of the laws of cuteness. And this is very intriguing. It's almost as if a brute economic force or law compels him to value the more compact hedgehog over its larger, more cumbersome brethren. Now, this association between cute animals and wealth and status exists to this day if you look hard at our culture. I'd invite you to join me in the following thought experiment. So suppose you see two people walking down the street, okay? Now, one of them is walking a Rottweiler on a leash, and the other one is holding a Chihuahua in their arms. Now, just take a wild guess for me. Which one of these people do you suppose has higher wealth and status? Thank you.